continue at verse 3. Paul says, I thank my God upon every remembrance of you. What a verse. I'm sitting there in vacant and intensive mood, and a thought comes into my mind, Jeff Thompson. What do I think of next?
Thank God
for Jeff. Marvelous. That's how it is. Well, that's how it was with Paul. And where was he at the time?
In prison.
He was in Pentridge. Boy, as I've said many times before, I've preached the gospel many times in Central Lockup in Sydney. And one thing that made me happy on Sunday mornings was getting out again. Oh, if there's one thing that would keep anyone from a life of crime, it's Central Lockup in Sydney on a cold, wet winter Sunday morning. Always in every prayer of mine, making requests with joy. Now, the word thanks gives us the word Eucharist. No need to be worried about the word Eucharist. I enjoy going to the Eucharist. Eu means good. The charis bit means joy. Good. Joy. With overtones of grace. Thanksgiving. Joy, remembrance. What is remembrance? It is simply mindfulness. Don't need to think, the word just comes into your mind. You're dreaming away, Walter Morrissey. Oh, hallelujah, glory be to God, Walter. Marvelous. I just make this remark in passing, that when we consider this do in remembrance of me, the Lord's Supper, Luke 22:19, it's a different word. There are overlaps between the two, but the word in Luke 22 has in mind a conscious effort. It takes into account that we're forgetful people, and it provides a way for us to bring the things of Christ into remembrance. That's the beauty of the Lord's Supper. We invoke godly thoughts. We read, sing relevant words. We do specific things designed to help us remember what Christ has done. That's an effort. Now, I don't consciously try to remember the names of everyone at Ashford, except now and again, generally once or twice a week, I run the whole assembly through my mind and say, God bless this beloved brother, and give him more sense, this sort of thing. A petition for everyone. But that's a deliberate act. Now, the words prayer and request, same word, essentially. The AV's got an interesting habit. When it finds the same Greek word in a verse, it uses different English words to translate them. It does that all the time. It's one of the foibles, the oddities, of the AV translators, and it causes a degree of confusion. Not much, but some. It has to do with entreaty. Prayer with supplication and thanksgiving. The word to beg, the verb to beg, a very short verb, do, that's all. D-N-O-R-O is the word verb, I beg, do. And all the derivatives of it, the cognates of it, have to do with beseeching. Well, you know the old Indian adage, he who begs in silence, stays. interesting going around the garage sales. I say, how much is that? And somebody says, oh, well, would you pay a dollar? And I think, no, I'll give you 20 cents. But somebody else will say, it's a bargain, you can have it for $5. You're much more likely to buy from somebody that shows a bit of enthusiasm like that. Now, let's see, what does he give thanks and so on for? For your fellowship in the gospel, from this day until now. What does that mean? Now, for simply means concerning, when I think of you, I remember, that we work together in the gospel. We preach the gospel together. And fellowship means partnership, essentially. The word for communion, same thing again. In this instance, it means being provided for. Now, there's a whole lot of references in the passage there, and I won't have time to go through them all. The word fellowship is used in a whole variety of ways. It has to do with sharing together. There's an intimacy of relationship in it. And what follows there are a list of items in the New Testament in which Christians share together. How do we share together? In 1 John 1:3, we share together church membership. That's the way the brethren use the word commonly. Are you in fellowship, sir? That's what it meant. It meant, are you a recognized member in good standing of a listed assembly? Whether Paul would recognize that definition is another matter. There is fellowship in worship. When two people are together and one prays and says, Jesus is wonderful, and the second one prays and says, Amen, that is fellowship in worship, to share together in the beauties of Christ. There is fellowship in teaching. I talk with the voice. Ian talks with the fingers. I've no idea whether what he says bears any resemblance to what I'm saying, but we're having fellowship together in teaching. It's a word that's given a tremendous variety of use. There's a fellowship of understanding of doctrine. We all believe the same things, we hope. And then that last bit, fellowship in the gospel. The gospel is a very general term in Scripture. It has to do with the whole counsel of God. But obviously the whole counsel of God for any individual begins at conversion. The forgiveness of sin, the sacrifice of Christ, the death of the cross, the shedding of precious blood, the glorious resurrection, the triumphant ascension. All of these things are the gospel. But so too is the rest of the Word of God. If a person is not a Christian, then the things that I just said come first, because they are the most important of all. The word is used in Acts 16, the second missionary journey, the first visit to Philippi, when Paul preached to Lydia in the women's prayer meeting and got them all converted. He had fellowship in the gospel with them. And he cast out the demon-possessed girl and made an uproar, the demon out of the possessed girl, and made an uproar, and they put him in jail, and then he made an uproar. In the middle of the night. There was an interesting paragraph in The Age yesterday, I think, about a man with a flat on Flinders Street opposite. office at the station complaining about the racket that Christians make on the steps of Flinders Street Station with a large amplifier at 2 o'clock in the morning. I thought to myself, these are people after my own heart. Imagine preaching the gospel at 2 o'clock in the morning, even if it does keep some poor fellow awake. That's the alternative. Wake the dead in the vicinity of Flinders Street Station. Well, Lydia responded, and they had fellowship in the gospel with Paul. She gave him hospitality when he went out and preached. And the jailer had fellowship in the gospel. He got them out of jail and washed their wounds and gave them a good feed and listened to him. And he baptized, I must have had an enormous baptistry. He was baptized and his house. It's good to have your house baptized, I suppose, in the things of Christ, but I'll let you into a secret. It really means household, and that's the way it ought to be translated. Right, verse 6, being confident of this very thing. Now, being confident means I am persuaded. It doesn't mean, well, if you say it, I believe it. It means I've thought it over, and I am persuaded. I've made up my mind. As the old chorus goes, I will serve the Lord. I am persuaded. I have been into the matter deeply. I have made my decision, and here is what I want. I am persuaded of this very thing, that he who hath begun a good work in you will perform it under the day of Jesus Christ. Now, perform is a lovely word. Someone perhaps would say to me in the old days, what are you doing tonight? You're preaching the gospel. And I'd say, yeah, I'm performing at Pennant Hills Assembly. They seem to think it was funny. I say, that's a Bible word. I perform. They're thinking of a circus. Actually, it was very sober, like this meeting is today. We perform. But the word is based on one of the two great words to do in Greek. And it's the word that gives us our English word poetry. An interesting connection. Our Lord is doing a work in us, same Greek word, and we become, as a result, a poetry of Him. And the gospel should be a poetry of Christ. And the creation of Christ within should be a poetry. We Aussies don't have too much poetry in our souls, regrettably. We're very prosaic people. And a bit more poetry can go a long way. C.S. Lewis makes this point at length in one of his books, calling for more poetry in the lives of people. Well, let it go on until the day when our Lord Jesus Christ appears. That is the resurrection day for us. It's twice in Philippians and also in 2 Thessalonians 2:2 there. The day of Christ for the Christian is the resurrection day. And we are a poetry of Christ until that day. Are we? Am I? Tempted to quote Shakespeare, except I've forgotten. Now, it's the man that has no music in his soul, isn't it? Not that has no poetry in his soul. Is fit for cunning, evil, and all vice. That's Shakespeare. Poetry. This is Dora's holiday. We used to sing at school. This is Dora's holiday. With music, and dancing, and poetry. poetry, not much poetry in our Aussie lives. Tremendous amount in scripture though, sometimes lost in the set out of the AV, but it's there. The Hebrews went in for poetry strongly, not so much the rhythm and rhyme that we do, but they had a different poetry, parallelism of thought, they went in for, but that's another matter. Right, poetry in our lives until the day of Jesus Christ. Then the last movement has to do with caring Christian relationship. A lovely verse, even as it is right, neat in most of the versions, but right, and right means righteous. It's appropriate that Christians do this. That we think of one another with confidence that we are growing in Christ. Am I confident that everyone here is growing in Christ? Well, if I'm not sure, then it's my duty as a Christian to think the very best of the other person, which the facts will allow. And therefore, I am confident. And you might think, that isn't very realistic. In fact, if the other person's a bit of a dumbbell, well, we might as well think of him as he is. But Paul says, I think of you differently. I think of you as being a poetry of Christ for this reason, because I have you in my heart. Now, that's a lovely statement. I challenge my own heart with it. Can I say today as I speak here that I have Barry Shackleton in my heart? Can I say it? Does my heart warm when I see him? See, everybody makes me happy. I'm a positive sort of a person. Everyone makes me happy. Some when they come. Others when they go. But Paul was a man that improved his batting average tremendously. By that I mean is that increasingly he came to the state where when he thought of somebody, he was pleased. And when they came, he was delighted. Why? Because I have you in my heart. Now, years ago, at the college, I contemplated this matter deeply and discovered this, that the heart is never used in Scripture for the old pump that's in here. It goes thumpity, 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 thump for 70 years at 90 a minute or whatever. And there it is. Now, there's not time to expound the whole of this marvellous chart. There's the heart and the liver, you see, left and right ventricles, two compartments in each, and the circulation of the blood was covered by William Harvey in 1616. The main point is that the important words on that chart, which we won't go through in detail today, are Bible words. The blood circulates. In terms of Scripture, blood equals life. And it has to be reinvigorated. And it's reinvigorated when it's pumped around the circulatory system. For example, the lungs. That's up the top there. And see the words divine input? Our Lord breathed into his nostrils the breath of life and man became a living soul. Wind and breath in Scripture are words for the Spirit of God which give life to the individual. Pneuma is the word for the Spirit. There, never mind these ethnic words. But that's the word there. The English word is nearby. The Spirit of God rejuvenates the blood that gives life, and round and round and round it goes. Now down the bottom there, Well, I've got human input. That's the food we eat. And that gives us capacity for life. And that has to do with the bowel. And the Greek word is splanchna, and it's common in Scripture. The AV translators had fun with it. I love you all, says Paul, in the bowels of Jesus Christ. Now, there's an interesting theological statement. What he means is in the emotions of Christ, the way our Lord felt. The Greeks thought that the way you felt was down here in the tummy. Like we say, I've got butterflies in the tummy. If something goes wrong, that sort of thing. Or I've got a gut feeling about you, brother. Don't like the look of you much. A gut feeling, that is Greek thought. Well, rejuvenation. Back around the circuit again. Stinks. That's the noose. See? Noose. It's not a thing you put around your neck like this jolly Western tie. I know the word well because my father used to say to me when I was little, the trouble with you is you've got no nous. Same word, you see, he just pronounced it differently. It means you haven't got the brains of a bandicoot. That's the nous. You see, we think. But the mere act of thinking is not sufficient to motivate us. There has to be a pumping around the circuit. And for the Christian, it has to go through the rejuvenating section, the lungs, where the power of the Spirit takes hold of it. And when it comes back into the other side of the pump, it's in what the Bible calls the heart. And that's the essence of the whole chart. And that's what Paul means when he says, I have you in my heart. It's not that when he looks at a brother, he thinks, oh, golly, he's an odd one. That's the noose speaking. But cardia, that's the heart. No cardia, tachycardia, electrocardiogram, comes into the English language in many ways. It's in the heart that we feel, essentially. But it's not a free-floating emotion. Now, I'm all for emotionalism. Provided that the emotion is a response to fact, to knowledge, to logical input, then we can respond appropriately. But emotion that we generate out of nowhere can be very, very, very misleading. All right, those are all comments on the meaning of the word heart. When Paul says, you Philippians, boy, it's marvelous, I have you in my heart. I always reckoned that Paul was a real big-hearted guy. That he could encompass all those fellows that he refers to in a dozen or so churches which he had brought into being. Now, why do I have you in my heart? Inasmuch that both in my bonds, he's in prison in Rome and under Nero in the early days. Interestingly, the word bonds is the noun equivalent to the word beg, which I said before is the word pride in this context. Even as his imprisonment restrained Paul, so he laid hold on Christ and in a sense restrained him to work in the hearts of people in spreading the Christian gospel. Inasmuch that in my bonds and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel. There's some theological terms. All right, defense is apologia, from which we get the Bible school term apologetics. And apologetics is the title of the subject, teaching the kids to preach the gospel. So when we're going out in the open air on Sunday, and the subject for this week is how to preach in the open air, the name of the topic is what? Apologetics. Learn a new word. Throw it into your conversation. Amaze your friends. That's the defense. And the confirmation of the goal. We don't want confirmation. The Catholics have confirmation. We don't want that. All the word means is establish. establishment, that's all. Confirmation establishes us in the things of Christ. There has to be an inner response for it to work. The Archbishop of Melbourne, Mr. Woods, or Woods it was at the time, he laid his hands on my broad cream head at school and confirmed me, but it didn't take, not for a great many years after. Anyway, he didn't establish me in the things of Christ. Now, because they share these things with him, they are partakers of his grace. Grace is the circulation of the Spirit of God in the totality of the believer and all the fruit that that brings. And that makes them partakers with whoever they're fellowshipping with of whatever the service is of that particular individual. So no wonder Paul was happy with them all. He's in prison, but he's receiving messengers, he's having visitors, he's got Roman soldiers to evangelize for practice. Everything is just suitable for a keen Christian person to move. Never mind the bondage that it appears to be in. That bondage simply restrains him in a scene where everything is provided for effective Christian service. And how do the Philippians share in this grace? In all those things that have to do with communion. Like, for example, they bring him news, and now again, they give him money. Marvellous. Every Christian worker loves to be a partaker of the grace of his friends when they mail him something with a check. But it won't be tired him if he expects it. Then he might find it's not a check, but a couple of pages of strict, strong criticism. So what you don't expect, you're not going to be worried about. Well, sufficient for today. God willing, we continue from there next time. I should get through Philippians about the time of the rapture, I expect.